ప్రతి ఒక్కరూ ప్రార్థనలో ఏకీభవించండి. మనపూర్వకంగా దేవుణ్ణి అడగండి. ఈ రాత్రి నాతో మాట్లాడిన ఆయన, నీ వాక్ ఈ సాయంత్రం నాతో మాట్లాడు, నీ వాక్యం ద్వారా నన్ను దర్శించు. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we are so surprised to hear a testimony that speaks about your goodness and your greatness, and also speaks about the faithfulness of this wonderful couple who trusted you, who traveled that far to hear your word, to increase their faith and to receive a miracle. As they trusted you, as they believed in you, you proved yourself that you are trustworthy God, and you answered their prayers, and you have removed their tears, and you have filled their hearts with great joy and great blessing. As many as pray together this evening, Lord, I pray the same miracle will happen in their lives. The same goodness and your mercy will be explored in each one of us and in our every personal. Everyone will have this personal experience, knowing you and receiving blessing from you and experiencing greatness and goodness about living God. As we are going to study your word, I pray, Father God, that you speak to each one of us. Your word increases our faith. Your word enlightens our hearts. Your word strengthens our faith. And your word gives a solution to our problems. And your word releases the peace that we need. And as we study your word, let your peace that passeth all understanding rest upon us, dwell within us, lead us and guide us. And as I stand in this place to speak the truth, the Spirit of God, I surrender myself into your hands. Speak to me and speak through me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Dear friends, can you turn your Bibles to Book of Ruth chapter 2? Book of Ruth chapter 2. Let me read from verse 1 onwards. Now, Naomi had a relative on her husband's side from the clan of Elimelech, a man of standing, whose name was Boaz. And the Ruth, the Moabitess, said to Naomi, "Let me go to the field and pick up the leftovers grain, behind anyone in whose eyes I find favor." Naomi said to her, "Go ahead, my daughter." So she went out and began to glean in the fields behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she found herself working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. Just then Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters. "The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you," they called back. Boaz asked the foreman of his harvesters, Who young woman is this? The foreman replied, "She is the Moabitess who came back from Moab with Naomi." She said, "Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters." She went into the field and has worked steadily from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelters or in the shelter. Dear friends, will God mend a broken life? Will God mend a broken heart? Will God restore a broken family? If this is your question, Ruth, the life of Ruth is the best answer. Ruth's life was broken. Ruth's heart was broken because she lost her husband. The Bible says she was a young woman. We do not know the particulars about her age, but the Bible says she is a young woman, maybe between 20 to 25, or even we can exactly say how old she was, but she was a young woman. But then she lost her husband. She came to Bethlehem with one hope, the God of Israelite, or the God of Israel will take care of me, will meet my needs, or will provide my needs. That's the reason she said to Naomi, saying that your people are my people, your God is my God, where you die, I die. Do not ask me to go back. And she trusted God, and that's the reason why she came to Bethlehem. What happens when someone trusts God? Will God take care of them? Will God understand their needs? Will God provide what they need? If this is your question, the answer is yes. God takes care of those who trust Him. The Bible says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all things will be added unto you." If you seek God and if you seek His righteousness, the Bible says all things will be added unto you. All things will be granted unto you. And that is what Ruth did in her life. She trusted God. Though she trusted God, she did not remain quiet. She did not remain quiet. She did not remain silent. She was not a lazy woman. She came to mother-in-law and said, "My mother-in-law, I need to work. I need to go. Let me go and work." "Where will you work?" "I will go to the fields. They will not permit you to work there. You are not from this country." "But my mother-in-law, I understand, or I heard, that God who loved you people also loved poor people. I may not work along with your people, but at least I can go and glean the grains that those were left for the poor people." Does God concern for the poor people? Does God love poor people? If you ask this question, my answer is yes. Turn your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 19, verse 9 and 10. Chapter 19, verse 9 and 10. And see what the Bible says. "When you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God." God instructed in the law, saying, you got to care for poor people. You got to love poor people because I am the God who loves everyone. When I give you harvest, when your fields bear fruit, the Bible says, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. But leave, do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and also for the alien. The second reference, 23rd chapter of Leviticus. And 22nd verse, see what the Bible says. 23rd chapter and 22nd verse. When you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Leave them for the poor and alien. I am the Lord your God. Deuteronomy 24th chapter and see 19th verse, what the Bible says. 24th chapter and 19th verse. I'm speaking about God who loves poor people, who loves the needy. When you are harvesting in your field and you overlook a sheaf, do not go back to get it. Leave it for the alien, the fatherless, the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When I give you fruit, when I give you great harvest, don't cut your harvest till the edges. Leave the corners to the poor people. I love poor people. I love fatherless. I love widows. And God instructs his children or his people that you got to love them. How can you love them? By providing food for them. How many of you do pray for the poor people? Can I see your hands? How many of you do pray for the poor people? Can I see your hands? Only a few hands. But then when you pray or when you praise God, when you thank God before your meal, do you know what you pray? Lord, thank you for the food that you have given to me or given to us. Provide for those who doesn't have food. Feed the poor, O Lord. Remember to feed the poor and provide the food for those who doesn't have or who don't have meals. We pray and ask God to feed them. But we don't feed anybody. మనం ప్రార్థన చేసినప్పుడు ప్రార్థనలో దేవుణ్ణి అడుగుతాం, ప్రభువా మాకు ఇచ్చిన ఆహారాన్ని బట్టి మీకు వందనాలు, లేని వారికి మీరు దయచేయండి, మేము మాత్రం పిల్లికి కూడా భిక్షం పెట్టాం. ఇస్ ఇట్ ట్రూ? వి విల్ నాట్ ఫీడ్ ఎనీబడీ, వి విల్ నాట్ హెల్ప్ ఎనీబడీ, వి విల్ నాట్ రిమెంబర్ అవర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్ హూ ఆర్ ఇన్ నీడ్, వి విల్ నాట్ రిమెంబర్ అవర్ రిలేటివ్స్ హూ ఆర్ స్ట్రగ్లింగ్ అండ్ స్టార్వింగ్ వితౌట్ ఫుడ్. We will not remember anyone known to us. It can be a believer, it can be a church member, it can be a colleague, it can be a classmate. Though we know that they are struggling, starving, no food, and we don't even care for them, we don't even love them, but we pray for them. Mother Teresa said, helping hands are better than praying lips. ప్రార్థించే పెదవుల కన్నా సహాయం చేసే చేతులే మిన్న అని చెప్పి మదర్ తెరిసా చెప్పడం జరిగింది. హౌ ట్రూ ఇట్ ఈస్! హెల్పింగ్ హ్యాండ్స్ ఆర్ బెటర్ దాన్ ప్రేయింగ్ లిప్స్. డోంట్ ప్రే వెన్ సంబడీ స్ట్రగ్లింగ్ అండ్ స్టార్వింగ్. డూ హెల్ప్ దెమ్, డూ ఫీడ్ దెమ్. వీ నో అబౌట్ గాడ్, వీ నో అబౌట్ బైబుల్, బట్ సమ్హౌ we do not know how to practice the Bible. Two pastors were traveling together in the train, and they had long conversation, and finally lunchtime has come, and one pastor brought his own meals. And he opened his carrier, and then enough chapatis and chicken curry, and he prayed and he said the same thing, Lord, bless this food and feed those who don't have this food. And he started eating. But the next seat, an opposite seat, other pastor is watching. And he expected at least he would share the food along with him. But he did not share his food. He just eating his own meal, lunch. After some time, the pastor said, you know, the Bible says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. The one who is eating the chapati, and he said, do not desire of anything that belongs to your neighbor. ఇద్దరు కలిసి ట్రైన్లో ప్రయాణం చేస్తున్న ఇద్దరు సేవకులు, ఒకరి దగ్గర ఏమో భోంచడానికి ఆహారం ఉంది, మరొకరి దగ్గర ఆహారం లేదు. చాలాసేపు అయిన తర్వాత భోంచేసేటప్పుడు ఒకరేమో క్యారేజ్ తీస్తున్నారు, దేవునికి స్తోత్రాలు చెల్లించారు, ఓ తినేస్తూ ఉన్నాడు, ఎదుటివాడేమో చూస్తూ ఉన్నాడు, అరే పెట్టుకుని ఎలా తింటాడని చెప్పి అనుకుంటూ ఉన్నాడు. కాసేపు ఉన్న బట్టలు కడేశాడు. ఏమని తెలుసా, నిన్ను వల్లే నీ పొరుగువాన్ని ప్రేమించమని బైబుల్లో ఉందిగా అని అంటే, ఇటుపక్క తింటున్న సేవకుడు అంటున్నాడు, నీ పొరుగువాన్ని ఏది కూడా ఆశించవద్దని కూడా బైబుల్లో ఉందిగా. We all know about Bible. We quote Bible references, but do we practice Bible? That's a challenge. Unfortunately, we read Bible, but we don't practice Bible. If that is true in your life, you got to change your attitude. You got to change your lifestyle. The Bible says, remember the poor. Remember the widows. Remember the needy. And try to help them, try to provide them, try to feed them. Share your profits. Share your harvest. Share your blessings. Brothers and sisters, God blessed you not to be blessed, but to be blessing to other people. Remember this. God comforts us not to be comfortable, but to comfort others. Remember this. God blessed you. God blessed me not to enjoy the blessings, but to become channel of blessing to many other people. That is what the reason why God blessed each one of us. Why in Calvary Temple we provide education for the poor children? Because the Bible says. Why we give free medicine to the poor people? Because the Bible says, love those who are poor and needy. Why we provide pension to the widows and the elderly people, especially the one who lost husband and wife and living all alone? To such people we are providing a pension. Why? Because it's our responsibility to take care of our parents, those who are old. Why we provide a Sunday clinic, a free service? Why we provide free medicine? Just because the Bible says that we need to love the poor and the needy. Because our Calvary Temple is a Bible believing church. Calvary Temple is a Bible practicing church. We preach the truth. At the same time, God commanded us to practice what we preach, what we listen. That's the reason you see all these things here. Now, Ruth comes to Naomi and says, I know one thing from your God, or from your people, or from your book. A poor widow like me can go and grab the grains which were left behind. So let me go and grab those grains. Your brothers and sisters, to work behind the harvesters, to grab only those grains left by the harvesters, by mercy, by grace, by compassion, when they leave those grains, it is not easy for any young woman to go and gather those grains left by those workers. It needs a lot of humbleness. It needs a lot of humility. Remember,
Three things I shared with you now. One, hard work. If God wants to bless you, if you want God to bless you, then you got to work hard. The second thing, honor. You got to honor people at your house and you got to honor people at your work. The third thing is humble yourself. And Ruth has got these three qualities. She was a hard-working woman. She was a honoring woman. And she was a humble woman. She humbled herself. She did not act as if, you know, I am from rich family. And how can I go and gather those grains left for the poor people? I am not that poor. My parents are not that poor. I am from high-class family. I am from upper caste family. Those dialects you don't see from the mouth of Ruth. She is such a humble, down to earth. Do you want God to bless you, brothers and sisters? Then humble yourself. God loves humble people. You may be a poor. You may not be able to meet your both ends. You may eat only one meal a day. But if you are a humble person, hardworking person, a honoring person, God will definitely, dear brothers and sisters, definitely God will bless you. For some reason in our country, the dignity of labor, we don't see in many people. We think that we are called to do only certain jobs. Many sisters and brothers come to me and ask me to pray. And do you know what they say? Anna, please pray that I will only get central government job. No other job. Anna, please pray that I will only get government job. No other job. Why only central government? Why only private? Why only government jobs? I don't understand. For how long you are waiting for central government job? 8 years, Anna. How many years? 8 years. How long is he going to wait for his central government job? Maybe another 8 years. I don't want to work anywhere. I want to work only in that company until I get my job in that company. I will not work anywhere. No. Dear brothers and sisters, how long will you depend upon your parents? How long your parents have to send money for your hostel, for your mess, for your food, for the expenditures for your studies? How long they have to send it? I always advise young people, work somewhere. Do some work. Don't depend upon your family. It may be 7,000 or 8,000 and 10,000. Meet your minimum needs of your hostel fees and education fees and your mess fees, whatever it is. Work somewhere. Hyderabad is such a big city. You will get job if at all you want to work. There used to be a young man, I'm talking about 20 years back. He would knock our door and he would throw the milk packets and also newspaper morning 4:35 o'clock. End of the month, he would come and ask me, sir, will you please settle this bill, milk bill, paper bill. And generally I would ask him, how many liters you would sell every day? Sometimes he says 500 liters. Which means 1,000 packets. Or 250 liters. Which means 500 packets. How much you get out of every packet? He says 50 paisa. How much monthly you make out of this selling milk? 15,000 rupees. Then I asked him, is this is your business? No, sir. Is this is your job? No, sir. Then what will you do after selling this milk? I'm a student, sir. I'm doing my BSc. I'm a BSc student. Then why do you work in the morning and sell these milk packets? He says, to provide for my education. How long will I depend upon my parents? 2 hours. If I can spend 2 hours, if I can work hard for 2 hours in the morning, 4 to 6 o'clock, 2 hours, 15,000 I make, sir. I'm talking about 20 years back. He is not feeling shame to sell it, to sell milk packets. He is not being ashamed to sell newspapers. He says, how long will I have to depend upon my parents? If only I work 2 hours or three hours every day morning, I can take care of my expenditures. He really surprised me. God loves hardworking people, friends. God loves honest people. God loves humble people. Be humble. If you are humble, then God will exalt you. God will bless you. Now turn your Bibles to 1 Samuel. Let me show you one humble young man and his attitude. 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. First Samuel, 16th chapter, and see what the Bible says about this young man. The 16th chapter, 12th verse. 16th chapter, 12th verse. So he sent and had him brought in. He was ruddy, with a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, rise and anoint him. He is the one. So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power. Friends, David was a shepherd man, a shepherd boy. He was taking care of sheep. And all of a sudden, somebody ran to him and said, David, David, what's the matter? Samuel the prophet has come to your house. And he is seeking for you. He is asking for you. Why? You got to come and meet him. So David came to the house. And finally Samuel looked at the David and God said, he is the one whom I have chosen. Get up and anoint this young boy to be the king of this entire nation. And Samuel got up and he poured oil upon David and he anointed David to be the king of Israel in the midst of his brethren. Now, who is this young man called David? He is elect king. He was elected as a king. Many brothers and many sisters comes to me with great smile. Anna, Anna, praise God, Anna. What's the matter? I got joining orders, Anna. They didn't even join in the job. They didn't even join in the job. But they comes with joining orders. They're so happy. I got job, Anna. Here are the joining orders, Anna. Oh, they get so excited. Just by looking at the joining order. Now you got to understand how much David must be excited to receive this joining order to be the king of Israel. But you don't see that excitement. You don't see that he started daydreaming. Now I am going to be the king of this entire nation. I will be sleeping, I will be staying, I will be eating in the palace of the king. You don't see those things. Do you know what he does? Do you know what his father asked him to do it? See what the Bible says. Turn your Bibles to 17th chapter. 17th verse. 17th chapter, 17th verse. Now Jesse said to his son David, take this ephah of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread for your brothers, and hurry to their camp. Take along these 10 cheeses to the commander of their unit. See how your brothers are and bring back some assurance from them. David, come here. David's father called him. Father, what's the matter? Take these loaves. Take these bread pieces. What for? Take it first. Okay. Take this piece of cheese. What for? Take it. Okay. Now go to the battlefield and give to your brother and commander of army and bring me back an assurance of the safety of your brothers. David should look at his father. Father, I think you forgot. What? I am no longer a shepherd boy. My father, you forgot. You forgot that Samuel came and anointed me to be the king of this nation. I am no longer a shepherd boy. Don't try to give me these silly things to do. Why should I carry bread pieces? Why should I carry loaves to my brother? Even any servant in our house can do this. That is not the job of my caliber. Remember, I am elect king. Don't try to give me cheap things to do it. No, not at all, your friends. When father called and gave these breads or loaves to the hand of David and said, go to the battlefield and give these breads to your brother, he didn't say, that is none of my business. He didn't say, why should I carry these bread pieces? I am elect king. You forgot this. No, my friends. Though father gave him a simple job, yet he took it seriously. Okay, father, I will do it. He never got the anointing to his mind. No, I am not supposed to do it. I just finished my PhD. I just finished my MCA. I just finished my MBA. I just finished my MBBS. I just finished my engineering. I should not do these small jobs. I should only get into an MNC company, or I should only get a job in England or Australia or America or Antarctica, if you don't get anywhere else. No, I will not try to get job in small companies. Wait for 10, 15 years. Your grandchildren will come. Tataya, what are you doing? I am still searching for the job. Be humble. Do whatever is given to your hands. David was a humble man, humble young man, and he did whatever was given to him to do it. He took those bread pieces and cheese pieces. He went to the battlefield. He was so humble. He was not prideful. He was not a proud young man. Though he was elected to be a king, he humbled himself. Okay, father, whatever job you give to me, I will do it. So he went to the battlefield and then he found Goliath speaking rubbish things against the army of God. And he looked at that fellow and he said to the people around him, what is happening? What is he saying? Then someone said, he says, why we all have to fight together and kill each other? I will come on behalf of Philistines. You select one person from your side. We both will fight each other. If he kills us, we will surrender. If I kill him, you got to surrender to us. That's the challenge. Saul and elder brothers of David, nobody could come forward to take this challenge. Only young man, the David, who was so humble, he took a humble job carrying loaves in his hands. But as he was faithful in doing the job that Father gave to him, now look what job he got it. He said, is nobody coming forward from our army? No, not even one person. Then David said, I will go. I will go. He is coming with spear and sword, but I will go in the name of our Lord God Almighty. The battle belongs to my God and victory belongs to me. And he fought against the Goliath and he killed him. Dear brothers and sisters, whenever we speak about David, we always speak about David and Goliath. David has become world famous a warrior. Do you know why and how? By killing Goliath. But let me ask you this question. If David, if he was not humble to carry those loaves, he would not have become hero in the world. He would not have become a famous warrior in the history of Christendom. His humble activity allowed him to reach heights. Be humble. Try to do whatever work was given to you. That is what happened in the life of David. He was so humble. He carried only loaves and cheese pieces. But he did not come back with loaves and cheese pieces. But he came back as the hero of entire Israel. He came back as a victor. He came back as a great soldier. And from that day till he died, people spoke about David, how he killed Goliath. How could he get this wonderful opportunity to fight against Goliath? Because he humbled himself. Humility exalts you, dear brothers and sisters. Humility blesses you and lifts you up. Be humble and try to do whatever you can to take care of your needs. Beside, try your best to do your best for the things which you are seeking for. When David was selected to be the king, he did not daydream, and he was willing to carry the loaves and cheese. He was so humble to do. He was so humble to do small things. He was so humble to do small jobs. And that has exalted him. The same thing is happening now in the life of Ruth. Ruth was so humble, she was willing to go behind the harvesters and willing to collect and grab all the grain left for the poor and needy and widows. For a foreigner, for a young woman, it is not so easy to gather all the grains, the leftovers. People may laugh at her. They may speak things that will utter. They may speak things which will definitely offend her. But she decided to go and grab those grains because they will feed me. God loves humble people. Dear brothers and sisters, do you know what David said? When he was so blessed, do you think that David was born in a great, great, great family? No. Turn your Bibles and see what David says. See what David says. 2 Samuel 7th chapter.
7th chapter, 2nd Samuel, 7th chapter, verse 18. See what David says about his family. Then King David went in and sat before the Lord and said, now King David is now king. King David went to the Lord and said, who am I? Look how he speaks to God. Who am I? Oh, sovereign Lord. And what is my family that you have brought me this far? What is my family? Who am I? I'm not worthy to be king. My family is not great family. And yet you have blessed me. You brought me this far. Look at how humble David was when he became king. God loves humble people. The Bible says, pride goes before destruction. Humility before exalting by God. See what the Bible says. Turn your Bibles to Judges. Chapter 6 verse 15. Judges, chapter 6, verse 15. Look at one more warrior, what he says. 6th chapter, verse 15. But Lord, Gideon said, how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. Look what Gideon says. నా వంశము చాలా చిన్నది, తక్కువది. నేను మా ఇంట్లో కనిష్కుణ్ణి, చిన్నవాణ్ణి. అసలు నేను ఏ పాటి వాణ్ణి? ఇశ్రాయేలీలను శత్రు చేతిలో నుంచి విడిపించడానికి నా వంశము ఏ పాటిది? నేనే పాటి వాణ్ణి. దట్స్ హంబుల్నెస్. గాడ్ కమ్స్ టు గిడియన్ అండ్ సేస్, గిడియన్, యు గాట్ టు గో అండ్ సేవ్ ఇజ్రాయెల్. Look what Gideon says, 16th verse, or 15th verse. But the Lord, Gideon asked, how I can save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. The Lord said, I will be with you, because I will be with you. Gideon, I will be with you. Why, Lord? Because you are so humble. I love humble people. You said, who am I? What is my family? That's the reason I want you. That's the reason I selected you. Whenever you see that God selected, elected, and made them great, they were the humble people. When you look at Moses, when God said, Moses, I need you, come, I will make you a leader. Moses said, no, Lord, I cannot be a leader. Why? People will ask me, who am I? And will ask me, who are you? Not only that, Lord, I can't speak properly. I have a stammering lips. I can't even speak properly. I'm not worthy. When God is asking Moses to come and be the leader and lead Israel out of Egypt, and Moses says, I'm not worthy. Lord, I am not worthy. Please select somebody else. Why do you want me? Because you are so humble. That's the reason I want you. Dear brothers and sisters, if God's grace should bestow upon you, rest upon you, then he needs to find you that you are humble. Ruth was a humble woman. She was willing to do a job that is very, very, very down, at least in the society. And yet she was willing to do it because
Her problem is her survival. How can we live without food? I will do any job, whatever least job possible, in order to feed you, auntie, and take care of my needs. God loved it. Hard work, a spirit of honoring, a spirit of humbleness is what God seeks, is what God honors, is what God wants. Question yourself, do you have this spirit of humbleness? If you have, God will bless you. Before I close, let me share this with you. An old couple, they've got enough properties, but then they have come together with one decision. Let's give entire property to Bible college so that even if we die, they will keep trying Bible students so that they will go and preach the good news to the perishing world. So they went to one Bible college. They were very old. They spoke to the principal saying that we have come to donate some money for the Bible college. The principal thought, these old people, what will they give? And he was not even caring them. He said, if you want to give some donation, there is one donation box there. You can donate there and you can go. They were so upset by seeing this man with a haughty and a prideful spirit. And then they went to another Bible college. There was a room called director, and the director is not there. And now they are searching for the director, and they found a gardener. So the gardener saw this old couple and he came and said, how can I help you? This old couple said, we have come to give some donation to the Bible college and we want to meet the director. Then the gardener said, please kindly be seated. Do you like to have some water or some tea or coffee? And they said, yes, coffee is fine. This gardener went and prepared coffee and he brought the coffee and gave to these old people who came in cold and weather. And after having coffee, this old couple said, we want to meet the director. We want to donate some money for the Bible college. And he said, just wait 5 minutes. And he went, he removed his gardening clothes and he came back in nice dress and he came back and said, yes, please tell me. The old couple said, we have seen you. I think you're a gardener here. We don't want to talk to you. We want to talk to your director. Will you please call your director? Then the gardener said, I am the director. No, you are the gardener. You are the office boy. He said, no. I have leisure time. Students are in the class. Faculty are teaching the classes. What will I do being idle? So I was working in the garden. So whenever people like you come, I can have a staff who can take care of you, provide coffee and tea, but I am idle. I can even take care of that. That's the reason why I brought coffee to you. That's the reason why I was working in the garden. I am the director. Please tell me, sir, what is that you want to do with us? The gentle couple, they wrote a check and they gave to him. He was so shocked. And he was so thrilled. Are you sure? Are you sure that you want to donate this much money to our college? The old couple said, yes. And the old couple said, how much money you need to establish an university? The director said, this much will cost for university. The old couple, do you know what they did? They took the check back and they wrote the new check and gave to him and said, you build the university and we will take care of the financial needs. He was so shocked. And therefore, one of the best university in America came into existence just because of this humbleness of the director. Don't let your status, don't let your education, don't let your smartness steal you from God's goodness and mercy, dear friends. Humbleness will take you to the next level in your life. Be humble as David was humble. Be humble as Gideon was humble. Be humble as Moses was humble. And be humble as Ruth was humble. Through her humbleness, she gained whatever she lost. Through her humbleness, she became one among those who are the ancestors of Jesus Christ. Be humble. That will take you to next level. If you believe this, if you want to practice humble spirit, let's pray together. Let's all pray together. కష్టపడి పనిచేయండి, ఇతరులను గౌరవించండి, తగ్గించుకోండి. తగ్గింపు తత్వంతోనే మీ జీవితాలను ముందుకు తీసుకెళ్ళండి. మోషే తగ్గింపు, దావీదు తగ్గింపు, రూతు తగ్గింపు, గిద్యోను తగ్గింపు వారిని ఉన్నత స్థాయికి తీసుకెళ్ళింది. నీ చదువు ఎంతైనా కావచ్చు, నీ జీతం ఎంతైనా కావచ్చు, నీ రాబడి ఎంతైనా కావచ్చు, ఎంత ఖరీదైన కార్లో నువ్వు రావచ్చు, ఎంత ఖరీదైన ఇంటిలో నువ్వు ఉండొచ్చు, కానీ గర్వానికి మాత్రం తావివ్వద్దు. అది నిన్ను నాశనం చేస్తుంది. మహారాజు అయిన తర్వాత దావీదు అంటున్నాడు, నేను ఏ పాటి వాడినయ్యా, నా కుటుంబం ఏ పాటిది? ఆ స్పిరిట్ దేవుడు కోరుకుంటున్నాడు. రూతు అంటుంది, నేను వెళ్ళి పరిగెలు ఎరుక్కుంటాను. అది చాలా పేదవాళ్ళు చేసే పని. అంతకంటే గొప్ప పని నేను చేయగలను. నేను పెద్దనేగా, సిగ్గుపడలేదు. పని చేయడానికి సిగ్గుపడకండి, కష్టపడి పని చేయడానికి సిగ్గుపడకండి. ఉద్యోగం లేనప్పుడు ఏదో ఒక పని చేయడానికి సిగ్గుపడకండి. ఏదో ఒక పని చేసి మొదటగా మీ కాళ్ళ మీద నేను నిలబడండి, కడుపు నిండా బౌన్ చేయండి. అలాగే కష్టపడి ఒకవైపు చదవండి, ఇంటర్వ్యూస్కు వెళ్ళండి. కానీ ఇంట్లో మాత్రం ఖాళీగా కూర్చోకండి, హాస్టల్లో మాత్రం ఖాళీగా కూర్చోకండి. పిచ్చి పట్టేస్తుంది, డిప్రెషన్ మిమ్మల్ని వేధించేస్తుంది. ఏదో ఒక పని కల్పించుకోండి, ఏదో ఒక పనిలో జారండి. దావీదు చిన్న పని చేయడానికి నామోషిగా ఫీల్ కాల, రాజుగా ఏర్పరచబడిన తరువాత తండ్రి పిలిచి రొట్టెలు పట్టుకెళ్ళమంటే గర్వంగా మాట్లాడలా, రొట్టెలు పట్టుకెళ్ళాడు. నాన్న నేనెందుకు చేయాలి ఈ పని? ఇది మన ఇంట్లో ఏ పాలేరైనా చేయగలడు, ఏ పనివాడైనా చేయగలడు, ఇది నా పని కాదు అనలేదండి. తన చేతికి ఏ పని ఇస్తే ఆ పని దావీదు మనఃపూర్వకంగా చేసేవాడండి. కాబట్టే ఆ రొట్టెలు తీసుకుని యుద్ధానికి వెళ్ళాడు. అక్కడ గొల్యాతును చూశాడు, తన స్థితి గతి మారిపోయిందండి. వెళ్తున్నప్పుడు రొట్టెలు పట్టుకెళ్ళాడు, వస్తున్నప్పుడు ఆ గొల్యాతు తలకాయ తీసుకొచ్చాడు. వాట్ ఎ చేంజ్! అది తనను దేశంలోనే గొప్పవాణ్ణి చేసేసింది. ఆ రొట్టెలు పట్టుకెళ్ళడానికి తాను ఒకవేళ నామోషిగా ఫీల్ అయ్యి గర్వంగా ఫీల్ అయ్యి నేను వెళ్ళనన్నట్లయితే వస్తూ దేశాన్ని గెలిపించేవాడిగా వచ్చేవాడు కాదు. తగ్గింపు తత్వము నీకు అవకాశాలు ఇస్తుంది, తగ్గింపు తత్వము నిన్ను హెచ్చిస్తుంది, తగ్గింపు తత్వము దేవుని యొక్క ఆలోచనలను నీకు దగ్గరగా తీసుకొస్తుంది. తగ్గించుకో సహోదరి, తగ్గించుకో సహోదరుడు, అదే నీ జీవితాన్ని ఉన్నతమైన స్థితికి తీసుకెళ్తుంది. తనను తాను తగ్గించుకుని వారిని దేవుడు ఏం చేస్తాడు? హెచ్చిస్తాడు. గర్వించువాడు తిరుగు లేకుండా పడిపోతాడు. తగ్గింపు తత్వంతో ముందుకెళ్తామన్న వారు ఉన్నట్లయితే మీ హస్తాన్ని ప్రభు చూపిస్తారా? గ్రేషియస్ అండ్ హెవెన్లీ ఫాదర్, హార్డ్ వర్కింగ్, హానరింగ్ అదర్స్ అండ్ హంబుల్ స్పిరిట్ వర్ ద సీక్రెట్ ఆఫ్ రూత్ సక్సెస్. As you spoke to each one of us, Lord, I pray, as David humbled himself, Gideon and Moses, as they humbled themselves and you have exalted them, you have blessed them, you made them great leaders and king. As many as receive this message this evening, Lord, I pray that they will humble themselves and they will work hard in whatever they do it. And they will respect people in and around. And they will always practice the spirit of humility. which you love it, which you like it, and which you will exalt it. As we have meditated this, Lord, let the word become real in our lives. Let your word live in us, lead us and guide us and uphold us and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Devudi rosu matho matladadu annavar devudu mayim parustu chapalu kottara.